with our colleague Dr. Sharif Hassanein. He is going to talk to us about the difference is more life, 5 years overall survival with Kisqali. Dr. Sharif.
Thank you for the organizing committee, and thanks for Novartis for giving me this chance to talk about Kisqali or ribociclib. The difference is longer life, 5 years overall survival with Kisqali. I am Sharif Hassanein, lecturer of clinical oncology at Shams University. Objectives of my presentation will be to review clinical evidence supporting superior overall survival achieved with Kisqali in 3 phase 3 trials and in 3 distinct patient populations, and to review the evidence of superior efficacy with improved or maintained quality of life with Kisqali, and to discuss what makes Kisqali different from other CDK4/6 inhibitors. Kisqali or ribociclib is indicated for women, treatment of women with hormone receptor positive, HER2 negative, locally advanced or metastatic breast cancer in combination with an aromatase inhibitor or fulvestrant, either as initial endocrine-based therapy or in women who have already received a prior endocrine therapy for their advanced disease. In case of pre or perimenopausal females, endocrine therapy used should be combined with an LHRH analog for ovarian ablation. When considering options for advanced breast cancer, what is our primary or first treatment goal? Previously, females and physicians both were surveyed and were asked about their primary treatment goal in case of treatment of advanced breast cancer, and the answer was overall survival. So overall survival is our primary and the most important treatment goal regarding physicians and patients as well. Achieving a statistical significant difference in overall survival in hormone receptor positive, HER2 negative advanced breast cancer clinical trials has always been a challenge. In nearly 25 years, the 5-year survival rates for this type of breast cancer have been improved by less than 5%. Over the past decade, few studies with targeted therapies have reported statistically significant improvements in overall survival. Several factors make achieving an overall survival benefit difficult in advanced breast cancer, especially when it comes to earlier lines of therapy, due to the receipt of several lines of subsequent therapy which dilute the effect of the first line, and so this leads to the use of endpoints such as progression-free survival, which has become a clinically meaningful endpoint for advanced breast cancer. However, improvements in PFS have not been consistently translated into an overall survival benefit. And as with other targeted therapies, improvements in PFS seen with the CDK4/6 inhibitors have not been consistently linked to an overall survival benefit. Despite all of these and despite the challenges, Kisqali has shown statistically significant improvements in overall survival across 3 different phase 3 clinical trials. So the difference is superior survival or longer survival. First, we have the MONALEESA 2. It was a phase 3 double-blind placebo-controlled study of ribociclib plus letrozole in hormone receptor positive, HER2 negative advanced breast cancer. Patients were premenopausal, no prior therapy for advanced disease was allowed. 668 patients were randomized either to receive ribociclib, 600 milligrams per day, 3 weeks on, 1 week off, plus letrozole or placebo plus letrozole, and the primary endpoint was progression-free survival. The key inclusion criteria for this trial was either patients had de novo metastatic disease with no prior endocrine therapy. If the patient had received the endocrine therapy for her early setting, she had to complete these treatments more than 1 year. Histologically proven breast cancer, of course, ER positive, HER2 negative, and a good performance status. The key exclusion criteria was inflammatory breast cancer, CNS metastasis, and active cardiac disease. At the second interim analysis for this trial with a median follow-up of 26.4 months, the median PFS in the ribociclib plus letrozole arm was 25.3 months versus only 16 months in the placebo. And this translated into a hazard ratio of 0.56 with a significant p-value. So the trial was a positive trial and the primary endpoint was met. Early separation of the PFS curves demonstrated that treatment effects of ribociclib plus letrozole was as early as 8 weeks. This is maybe an important point. Some of our patients may have visceral metastasis, and some of the physicians may be reluctant to use CDK4/6 inhibitors in these patients if they need to have an early response, but it is the case in Kisqali because fast tumor response takes place as early as 8 weeks. A few days ago in the ESMO 2021, the final analysis from MONALEESA 2 was revealed, and Kisqali has reported a statistically significant difference in overall survival, not only PFS, and it achieved longer than 5 years median overall survival. The median overall survival in the Kisqali arm was 63 months, more than 5 years, compared to only 51.9 months in the placebo plus letrozole arm, with a hazard ratio of 0.76 and a p-value of 0.004. Kisqali is unique that it has been studied in a wide range of patient populations with variety of endocrine partners. If we look to both MONALEESA 3 and 7 together, we will see that Kisqali ribociclib was used almost in all clinical scenarios, either as a first line, either as a second line, in patients who had early relapse, and this was in MONALEESA 3. It was used in patients with bone-only metastasis, as well as in patients with visceral disease. It was used in patients with a relatively low number of metastatic sites, less than 3, and also in patients who had 3 or more metastatic sites. It was used in combination with fulvestrant in MONALEESA 3 and in combination with non-steroidal aromatase inhibitor or tamoxifen in MONALEESA 7. So, all clinically relevant scenarios and all endocrine-based combinations were evaluated with ribociclib. Kisqali significantly improved overall survival in combination with fulvestrant in MONALEESA 3 trial. The median overall survival was not reached in the Kisqali arm. It exceeded 5 years, compared to only 40 months in the placebo plus fulvestrant arm, with a hazard ratio of 0.72, which means 28% reduction in the risk of death for the patients and a p-value of 0.004. At 42 months of follow-up, 57% of the patients in the Kisqali arm were still alive, compared to only 45% in the placebo arm. So Kisqali showed an early separation from the placebo. If we look to the Kaplan-Meier curves, there is early separation of the two curves, which continued over time regarding overall survival. In MONALEESA 7, the data is very similar and the numbers are very similar. Also, we have more than 5 years overall survival in the Kisqali arm, either combined with non-steroidal aromatase inhibitor or tamoxifen, versus 40 months in the placebo arm, with a very similar hazard ratio of 0.7 and a significant p-value. At 42 months of follow-up, 70% of our patients were still alive in the Kisqali arm, compared to only 46% in the placebo arm. So at 42 months, survival rate was 70% with Kisqali. So if we look to post-trials together, MONALEESA 3 and 7, postmenopausal and the premenopausal in 7, the intention to treat population in post studies got benefits regarding overall survival from the use of different Kisqali combinations. If we look to the subgroups in MONALEESA 3, all clinically relevant subgroups got benefits regarding overall survival in the study, including those who used treatment as a first line or second line, including those elderly more than 65 years or younger patients, and also regardless of the number of metastatic sites, all subgroups got benefits regarding overall survival. In MONALEESA 7, the same, prior chemotherapy in the metastatic setting was allowed in this trial, and also patients who received prior chemotherapy in this trial got a benefit. Patient with lung or liver involvement also got a benefit. So all clinically relevant subgroups and all scenarios got a benefit regarding overall survival in both MONALEESA 3 and 7. If we come to the progression-free survival, which was the primary endpoint in the two trials, it was improved and increased in both trials. If we talk about the intention to treat population in MONALEESA 3, it was 12.8 months in the placebo arm versus 20 months. If we focus on patients who used the combination as first line only, it improved from 19 months to 33 months. In MONALEESA 7, if we talk about the intention to treat, PFS was improved from 13 months to 23 months. And when it was combined with non-steroidal aromatase inhibitors, excluding those who use the combination with tamoxifen, the PFS was more than doubled from 13.8 to 27.5 months. Hazard ratio in all the groups is very similar, ranging from 0.5 to 0.55, with a significant p-value in the intention to treat in both trials. When it comes to patients with liver metastasis, many of the oncologists may be reluctant or hesitant to use endocrine-based combinations in patients with liver mets, and some of us may prefer to use chemotherapy in these relatively serious patients or risky patients. But the data coming from both MONALEESA 3 and 7 revealed that the use of Kisqali combinations are safe and effective. The median overall survival in patients with liver metastasis improved in MONALEESA 3 from 24.1 months to 36.1 months. We have more than 1 year gain in overall survival with hazard ratio of 0.6. The same applies to MONALEESA 7. When we focus on the patients who received non-steroidal aromatase inhibitors added to Kisqali, the median overall survival was not reached in the Kisqali arm versus only 33.6 months in the placebo arm. So Kisqali was associated with a 37% reduction in the risk of death in patients with liver metastasis in MONALEESA 3 and 47% reduction in the risk of death in MONALEESA 7 non-steroidal aromatase inhibitor cohort. Across both studies, subsequent treatments were similar. As we mentioned in our presentation, that the effect of the treatments on overall survival is usually diluted by the use of subsequent lines. In spite of this, we have about more than one quarter in the placebo arm, more than one quarter of patients in the placebo arm in MONALEESA 3 used a subsequent CDK4/6 inhibitor after the trial or after progression on the first line. And about one-fifth in the placebo in 7 trial also used a subsequent CDK4/6 inhibitor, and despite more patients in the placebo arm receiving subsequent CDK4/6 inhibitor, Kisqali consistently showed statistically significant improvements in overall survival over placebo. When it comes to progression-free survival 2, which is a relatively newly introduced concept in the field of oncology and in the metastatic breast cancer cases, it is defined as time between randomization of the patients on the ongoing trial till the date of progression on the subsequent therapy. The importance of PFS2 is that some of us may be reluctant to use aggressive combinations in the first line, and they may think that this may have a detrimental effect on the results of the second line or subsequent line. The data coming from MONALEESA 3 trial said that it is safe and effective to use a Kisqali combination plus fulvestrant because the median PFS2 was improved from 29.4 months to 39.8 months. So you can give your patients these combinations first line without being afraid of any detrimental effects on the subsequent lines. Patient with CNS metastasis, the numbers were very low in post trials, but overall the progression-free survival was also improved due to the use of Kisqali, but we cannot withdraw conclusive data from this because the numbers were very low. No new safety signals were reported in all overall survival interim analysis in both studies, MONALEESA 3 and 7. No new safety signals were reported for post-treatment arms compared with the results from the primary analysis. In the primary analysis, the most common adverse events of any grade that occurred in more than 30% of patients were regarding 3, neutropenia and nausea. Regarding MONALEESA 7, they were neutropenia, hot flashes, leukopenia, nausea, and arthralgia. A very important aspect also is the quality of life. Are we giving our patients a longer life at the cost of decreasing quality of life? First, we would like to highlight the importance of the quality of life, and we said see that ESMO guidelines, ABC4 guidelines, recommended that integrative oncology aims to optimize health, quality of life, and clinical outcomes across the cancer care continuum. And they recommended that healthcare professionals should be ready to change and adapt treatment strategies according to disease status, treatments, adverse effects, and the quality of life. So quality of life became in the past years a very important objective. And despite this importance of quality of life, many patients with advanced breast cancer still fail to receive adequate palliation for their symptoms, which could improve the quality of life. If we look to post MONALEESA 3 and 7, the overall quality of life scores was improved with the use of Kisqali combinations. If we focus on the 7 trial, the separate scores for pain and overall fatigue were improved. Remember that in this trial, we are talking about premenopausal patients, younger age, and so they may have more stress on the quality of life. They may be younger in age, and they need to do more activities and more daily jobs. And when pain scores and overall fatigue scores are improved, it will be a very good point for this younger age. So Kisqali improved the survival without affecting the quality of life. It preserved the functional status and the quality of life of the patients post-postmenopausal and premenopausal. Also, time to subsequent chemotherapy may be a very important objective. Many of our patients when come to the clinic may ask to delay chemotherapy as long as possible. In the 3 trial, time to chemotherapy was not reached in the Kisqali arm versus only 29.5 months in the placebo plus fulvestrant arm with a hazard ratio of 0.69. In 7 trial, also time to subsequent chemotherapy was delayed following treatment with Kisqali in premenopausal patients. It was also not reached in the Kisqali arm versus 36.9 months in the placebo arm with a better hazard ratio of 0.59. Are the 3 CDK4/6 inhibitors exactly the same, or at the cellular level maybe we have some differences? First, we need to know that CDK4 and CDK6 act as key regulators of cell cycle progression, as Dr. Naveen discussed in her presentation. CDK4 and CDK6 may bind to cyclin D to form cyclin D CDK4/6 complexes, resulting in phosphorylation of retinoblastoma protein and so activation of the E2F to drive cell cycle progression. But CDK4 is more pivotal. It has a pivotal role, or it is a pivotal driver of breast cancer progression. CDK4 cyclin D1 complexes play an important role in luminal epithelial proliferation and breast cancers. The ability of cyclin D1 to activate CDK4 was shown to be key to the role of cyclin D1 in breast cancer progression. These figures show that there is more CDK4 dependence than CDK6 in breast cancer cell lines. The CDK6 dependence is present mainly in lymphomas, but regarding breast cancer cell lines, CDK4 is more important and have more dependence. CDK4 messenger RNA is expressed at significantly higher levels than CDK6 in the ER-positive breast cancer patient samples. When we compare the 3 CDK4/6 inhibitors, we will see that ribociclib has more preferential inhibition of the CDK4. It is 8 times in ribociclib preferential inhibition of CDK4 versus CDK6. It is 6 times in abemaciclib, and it's equal in palbociclib. And as we mentioned before, the dependence on CDK4 is more important in breast cancer cell lines. The dependence on CDK6 is more evident in lymphomas. So Cascari showed greater activity in CDK4 than CDK6 dependent cell lines. Although we have no direct comparisons between the three CDK4/6 inhibitors, but we tried to discuss this at the basic level. Cascari also has another benefit or another feature, that the free drug concentration is higher than both abemaciclib and palbociclib. So Cascari has a higher concentration of free drug available to penetrate and act on tumor cells and contribute to in vivo CDK4 inhibition. So the three CDK4/6 inhibitors are not the same. We have more preferential inhibition of CDK4 with the ribociclib and more free drug concentration compared to abema and balbo. When it comes to safety, they recommended those modifications for specific adverse events. All of us know that neutropenia is the most common adverse event, and it may be the dose limiting one. Grade 1 or grade 2 neutropenia, you don't have to adjust the dose of your treatments. If grade 3 neutropenia occurred for the first time, you will interrupt the drug and you will resume it after recovery to grade 2 or less. If the patient developed another attack of grade 3 or she had grade 4 toxicity, neutropenia, you will interrupt the drug also, but when it is resumed after recovery, it will be used at a lower dose level. Regarding ALT and AST elevation, liver transaminases, grade 1 and grade 2 at baseline, no dose adjustment is required. If grade 2 developed due to the use of the drug, you have to interrupt your drug and resume the drug after recovery to less than baseline grade. If grade 2 occurred for the second time or the patient developed grade 3 ALT or AST elevation, you had to interrupt the drug also, but when it is resumed, it will be resumed at a lower level or the lower level dose. If the patient has multiple attacks of grade 3 or grade 4, when ALT and AST are more than 3 times upper normal limits with total bedrobin more than 2 times, then you will discontinue your treatment. Regarding QT prolongation, if the patient developed prolongation of the QT interval for the first time more than 480 milliseconds, you will interrupt the drug and will be resumed after resolve of the toxicity. If it occurs for the second time or if the period reached more than 500 milliseconds, you will interrupt the drug, and when it is resumed, it will be resumed at a lower level. If the QT interval increased more than 500 milliseconds or 60 millisecond change from the baseline, you will discontinue your treatment. So to manage these side effects, we have to closely monitor our patient. This diagram or table show the monitoring which is required to be done in patient receiving Cascari. You have to do complete blood counts and liver function tests at baseline, at the mid-cycle of cycle 1, at the beginning of cycle 2, and the mid-cycle also, and then at the beginning of the 3rd till the 6th cycle. If the complete blood count got stable after this, you don't need to have more evaluation of the complete blood count beyond cycle 6. Regarding electrolytes, less frequent monitoring is needed, only at the beginning of cycle 1, 2, and cycles 3 to 6, and also if no electrolyte disturbance took place, you don't need to more evaluate the electrolytes beyond cycle 6. Regarding ECG for QT interval, you will measure this at the beginning of cycle 1 and in the mid-cycle, then at the beginning of cycle 2. Also, if no change took place, you don't need any more evaluation of the QT interval. Cascari has a very convenient dose of 600 milligrams. It is convenient that if the patient needs to reduce the dose, Kaskali at baseline is received in the form of 3 tablets, each 200 milligram. So the starting dose is 600 milligram. What is different in Kaskali, what's convenient, that if you need to reduce the dose for any of the adverse events we have mentioned, all you have to do is to decrease or lessen the number of tablets from 3 to 2. So the dose will be 400 instead of 600. And if the patient needs another dose reduction, she will use only 1 tablet instead of 3. The dose will become 200 milligram daily. It can be taken with or without food. Regarding safety information, as we mentioned before, the recommended dose in adults is 600 milligram, taken in the form of 3 times 200 milligram tablets, taken orally once a day for consecutive 21 days and 1 week off. No dose adjustment is needed for mild or moderate renal impairments. Only severe renal impairments. Maybe you have to be more cautious as close monitoring of signs of toxicity is needed. Hepatic impairment, if it's mild, no dose adjustment is needed. If it is moderate or severe, you will start by 400 milligram instead of 600. No dose adjustment is needed for elderly patients. The only contraindication is hypersensitivity to the active substance. Regarding critical visceral disease, all of the CDK4/6 inhibitors are not recommended if the patient has critical visceral disease. In this case, we will use chemotherapy, of course, but the mere presence of visceral metastasis do not preclude the use of Kaskali, as we saw in the data. Neutropenia also is a common side effect, but you don't need to be very anxious about neutropenia, because febrile neutropenia is reported in about 1.5% only of patients exposed to Kaskali in the phase 3 clinical studies, and so rarely neutropenia developed or evolved into febrile neutropenia or infections. It is only 1.5% in the clinical studies. So although neutropenia is very common, but it always do not evolve into more serious or higher grades. Hepatobiliary toxicity, as we mentioned before, that elevations in ALT and AST has been reported, and we showed how to manage this. QT prolongation, the use of Kaskali should be avoided in patients who already have or who are at significant risk of developing QTc prolongation. Appropriate monitoring of electrolytes, including potassium, calcium, phosphorus, and magnesium, should be performed prior to initiation of the treatment and the beginning of the first 6 cycles. The very common adverse events which were reported in the Kaskali trials were UTI, neutropenia, leukopenia, anemia, among others, and the common toxicities were thrombocytopenia, febrile neutropenia, hypocalcemia, hypokalemia, and hypophosphatemia, among many others. Our take-home message or summary: Kaskali is the only CDK4/6 inhibitor that consistently have been proven to help women with hormone receptor positive, HER2 negative, advanced breast cancer to live longer. Although we see from the data of Monarch 2 that abemaciclib combined to fulvestrant succeeded to improve the overall survival, but what is unique with our drug is that the 3 phase 3 clinical trials, Monalisa 2, 3, and 7, all of the 3 trials, there was improvements in the overall survival in the intention to treat population, with a significant p-value and a very similar hazard ratio of about 0.7. We give our patients about 25% to 30% reduction in the risk of death, either used in the first line, in the second line, premenopausal, postmenopausal, combined with fulvestrant or nonsteroidal aromatase inhibitors. All these clinical scenarios were evaluated in the 3 trials, and the overall survival improved in the 3 trials, and this is unique for Kaskali. Also, it consistently delayed time to chemotherapy, and it improved or at least maintained the quality of life, and it is more effective regarding CDK4 inhibition, which is a key driver in breast cancer cell lines, as we showed. And thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sharif, for this nice presentation about the other side of the story regarding CDK4/6 inhibitors. And now, any comments or Professor Lobna, tafadali.
Thank you, Dr. Sharif, for your elegant presentation regarding CDK4/6 inhibitor. My question related to you and Professor Haney, as related to breast unit. Is there any data about the use of CDK inhibitor in impending vesra crisis, dual in vesra disease, and with rapid action in the first 2 to 3 weeks, you elicit a response with your patient with this medication, whatever the combination with AI, with fulvestrant. Is there any data about impending vesra crisis?
Of course, vesra crisis, the main problem is that we don't have a very consensus about the definite definition or the accurate definition of visceral crisis. When you see a patient with visceral metastasis, you as a clinician may have the opportunity to evaluate your case. If you need a very rapid response, if you think that this patient may, let's say, die from her symptoms or from marked decrease in her respiratory function or in the liver reserve, you will go to chemotherapy. But if you have visceral disease only, liver metastasis or lung metastasis, the data shown with Kiskali showed that as early as 8 weeks, 2 months, there was a response. More than 70% of patients developed more than 30% reduction in their target lesions. So if you think that your patient can, let's say, wait for about 8 weeks, or she will not deteriorate in these relatively short periods of 2 months, you can use Kiskali combinations safely.
I think the difficulty in your question is how to define impending. How to define impending vitrectomy? This is the problem. If we have certain well-defined criteria, we can agree this patient is impending vesra crisis or not. But I think this is something more or less variable. I can assess that the patient is in vesra crisis. You can assess that the patient is impending. Our colleague Sharif assessed the patient is not in vesra crisis, and so on. So there is a personal assessment because there is no clear guidelines regarding impending vesra crisis. Regarding CDKs, I think maybe if you want to use it, abemaciclib may have some data about visceral disease, may be better than bone-only disease. Otherwise, if you have the patient, as Sharif said, in a critical state, you can go straightforward chemotherapy, of course. But I think the question we must think about, what's actually the next step after CDK4/6 inhibitors? What's beyond progression with CDK? What's after this successful journey with CDK, whatever the CDK? Okay, it is better to use everolimus, so with steroidal, or to go for BI3K mutations, seeking for BI3K inhibitors, or to go directly for chemotherapy.
I think if the patient has BI3K mutation, it is logic and normal to go for this drug, BI3K drugs. If the patient don't have or doesn't have BI3K mutation, I think there is some retrospective data about the use of everolimus exemestane after failure of CDK4/6 inhibitors. Of course, it was not evaluated in any prospective trial, but I think there is retrospective data that this combination of everolimus plus exemestane will still work in patients who have already received CDK4/6 inhibitors. And I think this is the sequence. I think it is more logic to use CDK4/6 inhibitor in the first line, even if patient has only bone metastasis. As Dr. Naveen said, if the patient has a very low disease burden or single bone site, you can go for single endocrine-based therapy. But all the data reveal that the use of CDK4/6 inhibitors, even in patients with bone only disease, they are beneficial. Hazard ratio is strong. So if you use first line CDK4/6 inhibitor combination based, I think we may use everolimus exemestane in the second line if the patient doesn't have PI3K mutation.
Okay, thank you. Dr. Mohammad Sabri, last question.
Yes, I want to thank Dr. Sharif about his elegant presentation about Monalisa 3 and 7. I have an answer for a question for Dr. Rolobna about the impending crisis. In the last ABC5, they failed to define this very gray zone of disease. I think in our daily practice, we found a patient in a visceral crisis cannot receive any chemotherapy, especially for the patient with liver impairment. If you have a transaminases elevation 3 to 4 or 5 folds or elevation of bilirubin, you cannot give any chemotherapy. So I think the upcoming giving of CDK4/6 inhibitors in a bending vessel crisis is a very intelligent way to introduce, because you have not a highly responsive tumor like triple negative or HER2 positive. You have a tumor of luminal AMB responded with a chemotherapy within 2 months, and this is the exact time to achieve a response with CDK4/6, either for fulvestrant or for with the eye. My question to Sharif about the new player now after release of Monalisa 2 trials, which will mature for improvement in overall survival and PFS survival few days ago in the ESMO. You know that we have the Monalisa 3 trials using the combination of fulvestrant plus ribociclib as a first line treatment and second line treatment. And now we have two competitors with Cascali combination. We have ribociclib plus CI in the first line treatment with a very mature data in the last ESMO. And also we have a fulvestrant plus ribociclib in the de novo patients, keeping with data from subgroup Monalisa 3 trials, patients didn't receive any treatment before. Do you think for the patient with de novo patients, didn't receive any adjuvant treatment or any first line treatment for Hermann cell disease, do you think choosing of Monalisa 2 trials, keeping with ribociclib plus CI as the first line, or choose fulvestrant with a very attractive results of PFS and also as a first line for the de novo patient with ribociclib? I have no answer for this question, actually. It's a very difficult question, but it should be highlighted, especially after releasing of the Monalisa 2 trials two days ago about the consistent and mature benefit of first line AI plus ribociclib.
I think there is no direct comparisons between both combinations, and it will not happen, I think. We can extrapolate the data from the era in which we used the endocrine therapies alone. We have data that Fostrox or fulvestrant, if it was compared to non-steroidal aromatase inhibitors as monotherapy before the introduction of CDK4/6 inhibitors, it was superior. And also the absolute numbers coming from the data with fulvestrant is relatively higher. We are talking about 33 months median PFS in Monalisa 3 trial, and I think it is not precedented in any trial to achieve about, let's say, 3 years of median PFS with this combination. Although I think there is no direct comparison between the two combinations and it will not happen, but I think the absolute numbers is in favor of fulvestrant. Another point which may, as Dr. Hani said, after failure of the, or after progression of the combination, what we will use. If you are planning to use everolimus exemestane, I think it is more logic to not to use non-steroidal aromatase inhibitor as the first line, as the patient may receive aromazine and exemestane everolimus in second line. So I think it's better to start with fulvestrant plus CDK4/6 inhibitors, because the absolute numbers is very high and very beneficial, 33 months median PFS.
Yes, but after release of the last data from SOLAR trial and BELIEVE trial, that's we have 40 patients 40% of patients have a PIK3 mutations. I think with this new data, will change the treatment sequencing. If you have a patient with PIK3 mutations, he will need fulvestrant later on to be given with alpelisib. In the 40% of patients having these PIK3 mutations, which will be allowed to be done in the first progression on the metastatic site, I think for the PIK3 mutations, I think it's postponing fulvestrant to be given those alpelisib post CD46 inhibitor or upfrontly to SOLAR trial, and postponing giving fulvestrant in second line. For the patient of 60% of non-PIK3 mutations, I think your answer is very good to start with fulvestrant plus ribociclib as a first line.
Okay. Excuse me, I will just have a very short and very rapid comment because we are unfortunately delayed. Choosing in between your question, Dr. Sabri, in the NCCN 2021, as all of us know, the both are having a category one. So both, and it's left for us to, weigh your the condition, your patient. And for Dr. Lobner, so all of us know that in all the trials of the CDK4/6 inhibitors, when they compared the presence of bone or visceral and bone, and all of them, they showed that there is poor outcome, progression-free survival, or overall survival, if there is a visceral lesion. In spite that we can use it in the presence of visceral lesions. So, of course, if the patient is impending, or which is a very big question mark, because as Dr. Iheni said, that there is no definite definition for visceral crisis, and of course for impending crisis, so it's better, for my own opinion, to avoid the CDK4/6 and go for the chemotherapy in order to save your the life of your patient, and then after that we can go for the CDK4/6. Thank you.
Okay, thank you all of you for this very hot discussion. I know if we can continue, we may remain for hours, but I think the point of Dr. Sabri is a very intelligent one, because we have a new generation of medications, the PI3 kinase inhibitors. Of course, till now it's combined with fulvestrant, and so we may think that to keep this card for the next play, if I have both are approved, as you mentioned, so I may start with AI combined with CDK. So to have this card, a strategic card for the next step, after progression with CDK, I may have PI3 mutation, and so combined with fulvestrant. At the end, I want to thank all of you. Thanks to Dr. Sharif. Of course, thanks to Novartis for this nice symposium. And thanks all of you. Shukran.